one is Julie Hart, who is an ecologist with the Dutchess Land Conservancy. And the other, Chuck Mead, who many of you know, third generation farmer on the Mead farm. The farm was purchased by your grandfather in 1916. So next year is going to be the centennial of Mead Orchards, which is great. So these two people, I think, are the best, have a special vantage point from which to observe changing land use in Red Hook. And I can't think of two better people to look at the topic than these two. So we're very pleased to have you here. After Julie and Chuck do this little presentation, I hope you'll join us afterwards, and I'm sure they will be there too for refreshments in the tap room where we can continue the conversation. But before we start, I just need to make a few announcements about upcoming events. And if you're not already a member of Historic Red Hook, here's your chance to sign up for Historic Red Hook. And there are these wonderful journals that Maynard Ham does with little synopses of what Red Hook was like 100 years ago or more. But coming up in April, this Saturday, Saturday, April 25th at 11, there's a ceremony at St. Paul's Lutheran Church. It's the 300th anniversary of their congregation. And the SAR and the DAR are going to be putting medallions on all the tombstones of Revolutionary War soldiers. And Mr. Cornelius Allendorf is going to be saying something on behalf of Historic Red Hook. So that's...
I will keep my remarks to a bare minimum. Edward Everett went for two before Lincoln.
I'll go for three.
Right. Then on Friday, May 1st, the Red Hook Public Library and Historic Red Hook are jointly inviting historian Vernon Benjamin to speak here about his book, which is called A History of the Hudson Valley, From Wilderness to the Civil War. So the whole sweep of history, of the history of our region. Then on Saturday, May 9th, Apple Blossom Day, I'm sure everybody will be out anyway, but courtesy of a grant from the Pomeroy Foundation, we were able to get a historic marker for the library building, the octagon, a very special octagonal building. So there's going to be an installation ceremony or a dedication ceremony. I'm not sure what time of day, but that'll be on Apple Blossom Day. And then just so you know, and we're going to be publicizing this in the next week or two, Saturday, June 20th, we're hosting a free house and barn exposition, preservation exposition, and right here at the Elmendorf. It's going to be a gathering of all the experts in the area on every aspect of preservation of old houses and barns. So if any people who either own currently or are going to own are thinking of restoring their houses or barns, this will be the place to be. It's going to be a great confab of preservation-minded people. And so you will be hearing more about that. So with that, I think that's enough said. I'm going to turn the podium or the computer over to Julie Hart. Welcome.
Well, good afternoon. My name is Julie Hart. I'm an ecologist and I work for Dutchess Land Conservancy. I want to thank you for having us here today. It's really great of everyone to come inside on such a beautiful sunny spring day for our presentation. So I want to start by explaining a little bit about what a land trust is. We have a number of land trusts here in the Hudson Valley. Dutchess Land Conservancy covers the area of Dutchess County, and as you can see, we go up into Columbia County a little bit too. Basically, a land trust is a nonprofit organization that conserves land. And they usually do this in one of two ways, either by purchasing the land and protecting it and possibly opening it for public access, or accepting conservation easements on it. And the easement is a voluntary agreement between the landowner and the land trust, where the landowner is giving up their development rights, at least in part, to protect the land and the resources that benefit the public. And so basically that's why we protect land. There are all sorts of resources that benefit the public. The obvious ones that we think about in Red Hook are the protection of farmland that produces the food that we eat. You know, there's been a great resurgence of farm stands and farmers markets, and it's really great to see people getting so interested in local agriculture. We're also protecting the water resources on the land, the streams, the aquifers that protect our drinking water supply. And of course, a lot of protected lands are open to the public and can be available for hiking and other recreational activities, And of course, one thing that we always think about when we're protecting land is the scenic values. Dutchess County is a beautiful place, and we want to keep it that way. We want people to be able to drive around and enjoy the beauty of the landscape. And so let's focus on the town of Red Hook. Red Hook has done a really great job of protecting their land. They have been very, very proactive in terms of protecting farmland in particular. And so this map shows you all of the protected lands within the town of Red Hook. Now you can see that all of the green areas are easements that are protected by the Dutchess Land Conservancy. The brown is areas protected by government. This is the Tivoli Bays area, of course. And orange is properties that have been protected by other conservation organizations, in this case mostly Scenic Hudson and the Winnicke Land Trust, which is based in Rhinebeck. So as you can see, Red Hook has quite a lot of protected land. The total acreage in Red Hook is about 23,700 acres. And as you know, a great deal of the town of Red Hook is actively in agriculture. As of the last agricultural list, there are over 8,000 acres in the ag district in the town of Red Hook. And so that's almost a third of the town. That's significant. In the town of Red Hook, the Dutchess Land Conservancy has protected about 1,300 acres, and those other organizations have protected over 5,600 acres. So the total acreage protected in Red Hook is, you know, over 7,000 acres, which is pretty significant. That's over a third of the town. And so Red Hook has done a great job of protecting their lands, and I hope everyone is very appreciative of that when you drive around the town of Red Hook. Now I want to take a step back for a minute and look at the long-term trends in landscape change. This is some data that was accumulated by the researchers at the Harvard Forest, which is in Petersham, Massachusetts. And this data actually just covers New England, so there's no data for New York. But New York followed similar patterns. Now what we're looking at here is a graph showing the total forest cover in percentage over 400 years. And so starting in 1600, that's about when Henry Hudson sailed up the Hudson River, you can see 90% of the landscape of New England was heavily forested at that time. Now, as the Europeans came in and colonized, they were cutting down the trees to build homes, to build fences, build for firewood. And so the forest cover dropped precipitously. There was a huge loss of forest cover over the next 250 years. Now, a few things were happening in the middle of the 1800s. You can see that that's when everything kind of bottomed out and the forests started to recover. They started to grow back. So there's a lot of factors at play here. A couple of the important ones that I want to highlight are the opening of the Midwest. So around here is the Louisiana Purchase, which allowed people to be able to move to the Midwest. And right here, this is actually interesting, that's the invention of the steel-tipped plow. Because if you remember, when people started to move out to the Midwest, they couldn't till up the sod, the roots were too dense. And so when John Deere invented the steel-tipped plow, that allowed people to actively farm in the Midwest. And so as you can see, and of course there were a lot of other factors involved in that, but as you can see, there was a general population shift of Americans from New England out to the Midwest. And as a result, a lot of farmland was abandoned. And that's what's happening here. These forests are regrowing on abandoned farmland. And so what's happening here in the middle of the 20th century is you see that we start to lose forest cover again. And the key factor here is the advent of suburbanization. This is where people started to move into the countryside. And so that's where you start to see, again, this loss of forest cover. And this other line is the population of New England. That's on this axis here. So you can see that it was very low for quite a long time, rose very significantly over this time, and continues to rise. And so the population jumped up even while the forests were being cut down, recovering, and then starting to be cut down again. And this is a photo of the village of Red Hook. On the left, you see an aerial photograph from 1936. On the right is an aerial photograph from 2013. And so what you can see is that the village area was very densely populated in 1936, but a lot of areas immediately surrounding the village were open farm fields. And today, as you can see, a lot of that has been converted into subdivisions. But I would also point out that there is still a lot of open farmland, even within the village limits of Red Hook, and certainly immediately outside the village limits of Red Hook. So it's still a very, very agricultural community. And there are several reasons for that, and two of them have to do with the natural resource maps that I'm going to show you right now. So first of all is the topography of the town of Red Hook. Now this map shows the town of Red Hook. This is the village of Red Hook and the village of Tivoli. And I've zoomed it out enough to be able to contrast Red Hook with the town of Milan. Now as you can see, the town of Red Hook is pretty flat. There's this whole area of town that's quite flat. Contrast that with Milan, which is fairly steep and rocky. And comparing that map with this one, you'll see that the farmland soils very much correspond with flatter areas. So here in Red Hook, the brown areas are prime farmland soils. Those are the best for farming. And the yellow areas are the statewide important farmland soils. Those are, they have similar properties to the prime farmland soils, but they tend to have some sort of limitation. Either they might be on a little bit of a slope or they might be a little wet. But you can see that Red Hook has the highest concentration of farmland soils in Dutchess County. Definitely contrast that with Milan, where you can see that farmland soils are very sparse because of the hilly and rocky terrain of the town of Milan. So Red Hook is very well set up for agriculture. And so this is a map that shows Upper Red Hook in 1936 and 2013. And I'll turn it over to Chuck to tell us some stories about his farm that's been in the family for almost 100 years.
Thanks, Julie. Julie does a lot of unheralded work on all these sorts of projects. And I'm on the board of directors at Dutchess Land Conservancy, and I'm the chairman of the education committee. But Julie does all the work. Many, many activities happen at her hand. So, as was said, my name is Chuck Mead. I'm a third generation farmer in what we call Tivoli, but some people would say Upper Red Hook. My grandfather's stationery said Red Hook, and it said Hudson River apples across the top, in Upper Red Hook or Upper Red Hook. But now our postal address is Tivoli. So my grandfather bought our farm in 1916, and I don't know how much you can see on these maps, but we have the ones you can look at afterward. We're up here on this little loop, which at the time of this map and the time when my grandfather bought it, that was West Curly Corners Road. In 1948, they straightened it right to Route 9, and then our part became Sism Road. After the Sism farm, the Sism family, which still lived there at that time. In fact, Lou Sism for many years worked for my grandfather and my father, and when I was a kid, he worked for us. And my brother and I used to, I don't know if we took the light, but we always did annoy him. And we were doing what I consider very tedious tasks most of the summer, like hand thinning apples, because we didn't grow anything but apples at that time. And so we were always asking him if it was time for lunch or time to quit. And he would always say, "I can't keep pulling this watch out, it'll wear out." He had a pocket watch. So, but my grandfather grew a variety of different crops, and that kind of ties into the title of the talk. About land use. He had apples, but they were only near the barn. So my dad tells me that any apples that were too far from the barn, by the time they hauled them to the barn to pack on the wagon with the iron wheels, they were well bruised. Even by the standards in that day, they weren't acceptable. So the best places on the farm, the highest ridges, where the apples grew the best, they didn't have apples then. They grew wheat and other fodder crops, because they had a herd of Jersey cows. I don't know how many. My mom tells me there was one Jersey cow left when she and my dad married in 1951. So my dad was getting out of livestock, but I assume from the way the space in the barn was that maybe they had 8, maybe 10? Don't know. And they had some draft horses, which I heard a lot of stories about from my dad, and also from Lou Sism. He always said my grandfather didn't know the first thing about farming with horses. And he would go on to tell me in great detail what my grandfather didn't know about that.
But, tell him where he came from.
Well, my grandfather didn't grow up farming. He grew up, his father was a builder in Greenwich, Connecticut. And he built basically mansions in Greenwich and also in other places in Connecticut. And my grandfather and all of his brothers, I don't remember how many there were, three or four, they all went to Yale. My grandfather got a business degree, I think in 1910, one of those years. He went to Manhattan, was working in some kind of business, doing something, some kind of financial, and there was a downturn. So I don't know if he got laid off or if he quit, but he decided he wanted a farm. And so at that time, Cornell had a 2-year course in agriculture for folks who didn't grow up on farms. So he went to that course, and as part of that course, you had to work on a farm for the 2 summers. It was a full 2 years. So the first summer he was on a farm somewhere near Hartford. It could have been an acquaintance of my great-grandfather, but we don't know. And then the next year, he was at the Teeter Farm, which then became the Cole Farm, which then became the Geiger Farm in Upper Red Hook, and now it's mostly abandoned, or a little bit of it got subdivided, but most of it's still there. And actually, a little part of it I rented for a few years that was orchard. And so he, when he was here, I think it was in 1915, he found that our farm had come on the market. And so in the early spring, he wrote a letter to my friend Dave Fraley's grandfather, Curtis. Dave found the letter about 20 years ago, approximately, in his...
Maybe more.
Yeah, a while ago, he found the letter and gave it to me. And my grandfather had met Curtis at some point, and so he had written to him and said, I want to come up and look at the, I'm trying to think of the folks' names.
Boyce
Farm again. But I don't, you know, the trip is going to be arduous. But I want to come and make a decision if I want to buy it in time to plant something this year. And so we don't have the letter that Curtis may or may not have written back. But I did find in my mom's attic recently boxes and boxes of letters that my grandfather saved. So I haven't been through them all yet.
Oh, okay.
So it may be in there.
We'll help you. We'll help you.
It was just, my grandfather didn't throw anything.
Oh, that's great.
Well, I don't know.
Much you have to live with.
I know.
Great for you.
Great for us.
Yeah, yeah. But I inherited some of that. My dad had that too, although he kind of liked things to look neat, especially if it was your responsibility to keep it neat more than his. He liked it neat. But my son, Derek, he was at the farm a couple of different times. And he didn't really care for a lot of the stuff that nobody could use. If it was might be an artifact or it might have some use, well, then it was worth saving. But he cleaned out the basement of the barn in the fall of 09 after we finished harvesting apples. And there were things in there that had not been touched in my lifetime. in the former stalls of the draft horses. And he got that all cleaned out, and he saved a few things. Most of it was junk, you know. And we poured a concrete floor, and it's much more useful now. But...
you couldn't watch him do it?
No, I couldn't be there for a lot of the...
His son's a minimalist, if you will.
Yeah, but... So anyway, he lives on the West Coast now, and I don't know what exactly his intentions are, but that's another story. So, where was I? My grandfather, yes. Yes, so he had the cattle. I don't remember ever hearing that they had sheep, but they did raise hogs. There was another barn that's gone now that was in disrepair that we took down about 20 years ago. That was behind my mom's house. On the first floor of that, they raised hogs. The second floor was full of broken machinery and other household items that my grandfather stuck in there on the top floor, which had a sway like that, about 3 feet deep in the center, had lighter household items that were broken. My grandfather would say that. He really didn't like to throw anything out. I don't know if it was a depression or what it was, but it really, and I understand that. I can relate to that sense of not wanting to part with things, but you know, we try and Dave's shaking his head, yes.
Yeah.
You might need that someday.
Oh, yeah. I guarantee the first time you throw it out, the next day you're going to need it.
But can you find it? Yeah. So Anyhow, so he grew some apples. He also grew strawberries. The strawberries were right along Sism Road, where today there are once again strawberries. And they picked them in the wooden courts. We use the little green paper ones now. And they packed 16 of those into a crate. I don't know how they stacked them, but the crate was about that high. And it said G.G. Mead, which his name was George Gordon Mead, but he didn't like the name George, so he went by G. Gordon Mead. And the mysterious part of that to me is why he named his oldest son George Gordon Mead, if he didn't like the name George, but anyway. And then my dad was the second son, and his name was Sidney Bradford, and Dr. Bradford was my grandfather's college roommate at Yale. And so that was where that name came from. But anyway, back to the strawberries. They would harvest the strawberries, and late in the afternoon, they would take them to Tivoli, and down there were docks in at the river in Tivoli. There was a boat that would get them to Manhattan the next morning. And so the farmers would congregate there in the afternoon and unload the strawberries, or I'm not sure what else there would have been at that time. And then in the fall, it was apples. And the apples were packed in 3-bushel wooden barrels. And we have found over the years a number of the stencils that were applied, you know, used to apply ink to the end of the barrel, the head. We also have the tool to put the head in. You know, it's got, kind of looks like a gear puller. It's got a clamp that goes on each end of the bottom. And then it's got a wooden screw to, and a piece almost like a 2x4 that pushes the head down in. And they would go also to the river. And I can only imagine what those apples look like when you open up the barrel in Manhattan, or even if they went further than that. And they would get stenciled depending on which wholesaler they were going to. So we have dozens and dozens of these stencils. Some have varieties, some have the various wholesalers' names, and they're quite interesting. You probably have some of those as well, don't you, Dave? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, and Al Cole, when did he retire? Early 70s, something like that. Maybe late 60s, he sold to Frank Geiger. He had a collection of them that he had polished, so the brass was shiny, and they were very attractive. He had them in frames in his game room, I guess you'd call it, in the basement. Yeah, they were very attractive, I thought. But anyway, the truck that my grandfather had at that time was a Ford Model T. And I don't know, anybody familiar with a Model T? Mm-hmm. The gas tank was right where the present day dashboard is in a car. And so the fuel flowed down to the carburetor. And when you drove up a steep hill, like the one next to Tivoli, the gas didn't flow. So they would back up the hill. They'd back up the hill. I don't know if that would work with today's traffic conditions. But I guess at that time, Tivoli was a lot quieter. In fact, there's a story from maybe it was the late 40s, early 50s. A friend of mine who, you know, a guy who was my scoutmaster when I was a kid, went through Tivoli one time. I think it was in the summer. And he said there was a traffic light in Tivoli at that time. And he said there was a dog asleep right under the traffic light and the road. But Tivoli used to be a little quieter. And Red Hook was a little quieter. When I met with Chris and Claudine, you know, to talk about this meeting, Chris told me that today, 14,000 cars a day go under the light in Red Hook. And what did you say it used to be? 6,000 or something like that?
Oh, well, we've grown for, until Richmond through in 57, Red Hook was, the population for 150 years has been right around 3,500 to 4,000. And now it's 12.5, 13,000.
Yeah. Yeah. And I don't know where all these people came from. But they're here, you know. I guess they see what we've always seen in Red Hook, and they really like it. And they're here. So I don't. My dad never grew strawberries, but my grandfather did it at one time. And as I said, my dad decided to just grow apples, and so he got rid of the livestock, and he concentrated on apples. And about that same time, not too much after that, my grandfather retired. And
we figured out why he didn't grow strawberries.
Oh, my dad?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because as people walk through the roads, you couldn't push them aside so that people didn't step on them accidentally.
Oh, okay.
That's an old story. You have to know the first part.
You have to know it. Oh, okay. Yeah. But so my dad was very involved with the early efforts at planning in Red Hook. I think the planning board was, the first zoning was adopted in 1972, and he was involved for a number of years before that with the, I don't know the exact name of the group, but they created the put together the ideas and the that sort of thing for the planning. And then he was the chairman of the planning board for many years after that. 20 years, my mom says.
Planning for what?
Well, they were planning zoning.
Zoning.
Yeah, and he felt it was very important for a farmer to be involved with that. And I think that has borne fruit. So one of the things that I'm passionate about is that we not build houses on good farmland. That's part of the reason that all of my property is under agricultural easement, or conservation easement. And I'm pleased that so much other land in Red Hook is as well, although there's still a lot more that could be. And hopefully that progress will continue. So one of the other things that my grandfather grew, in 1918, he planted navy beans. And this isn't too serious, this story. So they were intended to be sold to the government for the war effort. And the way my dad always told the story was that the war got over, got over November 11th in 1918 before Grandpa could sell the beans. So these beans were in the barn, and every Saturday night, my grandmother would cook beans. And so fast forward about 20 years, when my dad and his older sister and his older brother were old enough to go out on the date, they didn't want beans on a Saturday night. So about 6 or 7 years ago, we heard from my aunt, who seems to know a lot of these stories. She's just since passed away. She was the last of my dad's four siblings to pass away. That the reason the beans weren't sold wasn't that the war got over too soon, it was that they weren't threshed properly. So it was just an interesting take, because for years I heard my dad say, oh, the war got over too soon, they couldn't sell the beans. But now Aunt Piz said, no, that wasn't the reason. Somebody didn't do something right and they weren't acceptable. So, so that's interesting. And I don't know if they actually ran out of beans or if they just stopped eating them. I don't know how long you can keep dry beans. They ran out. My mom says they ran out. But it made kind of a good story, I thought, about not wanting to go on a date. Beans, so my dad just pretty much grew apples. He had about 15 pear trees. He had a few half-dead plum trees. And they were pretty well at that I remember when I was a kid. And he used to sort of rent some land to a friend of his who grew field corn, but I don't think he ever made a dime doing that. It was a struggle because the fields are kind of clay and it wasn't a good idea. But so then I graduated from Cornell in 1978 and I started planting some different things. In 1980, I planted our first peaches. In 87, I planted some more peaches, some pears, and some plums, and it's kind of gone on from there. And we started to do farmers markets in 1992, which is 10 years after Ken started. And but we had a guy who was a friend of mine, who was one of the first people who IBM let go, and he was working for me. And at that time, when I grew up, a lot of my friends' dads worked for IBM, and you couldn't get fired from IBM. But things changed, and he got let go. And so he was working for me for a few years. And so he got us to start doing some farmers markets. And so we started to plant some other things. And in 1994, January 94, we had 29 below at the farm. So we, and at that time, Lynn and I had just been married a year or two, and we lived in her house in Kingston. And that, and when I was at school, were the only times I've not lived at the farm. But I was at the farm every day, but did actually live in Kingston. It was 19 below right in the city of Kingston. So we knew we wouldn't have any peaches and probably no plums that year. So this friend of mine that was working for me said, why don't you plant some tomatoes? So we went to see Ken. Ken told us how to get started and loaned us a few machines, and we started to grow vegetables. That's how that started. And so during the 90s, we added other things, and we began to see that, gee, the more items we put on our table at the farmers markets, the more money we came home with. So we kind of got a little carried away and started growing all these different things. And so we figured out some of them don't really work for our land and for our style. And so we cut back a little bit. But we did, in 02 we planted strawberries again, and then in 03 we started to plant blueberries and raspberries, and we continued to plant blueberries, I think, until 08, and now we have almost 6 acres. And the farmers markets have been good for us. It's not an easy racket. It's a lot of miles, a lot of hours, but it's been good for us. But still, about 3/4 of our apples are sold wholesale. And we work with Saltwell up in Claremont and Yonder Farms in Hudson. And so I wanted to ask a couple questions, if you don't mind. I like interactive talks. And are there any here that have lived in Red Hook their whole lives? Okay, cool. That's good. Yeah, and me too. Yeah. Except for when I was in case the only while. Yeah, my dad, actually Sid, he lived in the same house his whole life. Not only the same town, but he lived in the same house. For a couple months after my mom and he married, they lived on Pitcher Lane, about a mile away. Well, they were working on the part of the house that we lived in. And so he really did. He didn't want to go anywhere else. And my mom doesn't want to go anywhere else. So she'd been there since 1951. So, and it's an interesting story how my parents met. Mom was born in Brooklyn, grew up on Long Island, just almost in Queens, and she had an aunt who lived over near Tivoli, Aunt Dorothy,
yeah.
And what was her last name?
Hayes.
Hayes, right. And then Uncle Ernest died, and then she married Bill Friedborn from Tivoli. Yeah. But anyway, Mom had worked at the summer camp that was at Ward Manor, which is now part of the Tivoli Bays. Have you ever seen that stone barn with the iron truss roof that's still there? That was part of the camp, right? That stone barn?
That's where we lived.
That's where you lived in that building? I assume there were other buildings at the time when it was a summer camp. Yeah. So, but anyway, her Aunt Dee, we called her Dee when I was a kid. She was Aunt Dorothy before that. She lived right near the intersection of Kid Lane and 9G. And my dad and my grandmother delivered her cream. The Jersey cow's milk, they would separate. And the skim milk they fed to the hogs, which my dad always said made wonderful pork. And then the cream they sold. And so Auntie was one of the cream customers. And just recently, just last fall when I was doing a talk for a bus group at our farm, Mom was there, and so I asked her about this, and she told me that Auntie set it up as a blind date. Oh. Because I had been telling the story for years that my mom married the milkman. But then I find out it was a blind date. So, but Auntie was a real character. So it doesn't surprise me. She was a real character. She was an interesting character. And she had lots of stories from China and what was then called French Indochina. Her first husband was an administrator at an English school in China before World War II. So she had lots of stories. And she had a couple of full-size poodles, standard poodles, I guess you'd call them, when I was a kid, one black and one white. And all their commands were in Chinese. I assume it was Mandarin, I don't know. But they knew, but I didn't know. But because she, you know, she had picked up some Chinese when she lived there for many years. And so how'd the date go, the first date?
So had he eaten beans? He and a friend came, his name was Jim
who lived over on G. In fact, in the house that's now Wales Back In. It's not Wales Back In, it's
what's part of Bard?
It's a faculty residence, I believe. And the two of them came, and I was immediately attracted to Jim. But I had my roommate at Stone Barn, and so we went on this double date, and then soon Sid and I began dating, and then it was a while before we got married, but I think that he was the one that God had in mind for me right from the beginning, and so we were married until 7 years ago. And we had 3 children, and 6 grandchildren, and now 4 great-grandchildren.
Thanks.
Can we talk about the structure in the orchard, the poles and the wires?
Oh, yeah. Well, when my grandfather planted apple trees, the standard in that day was that the trees were 40 feet apart, 40-foot wide rows, and 40 feet between trees. And he had some that were closer than that, and some of the ones that my dad planted in the 40s were a fair bit closer than that. But that works out to 27 trees on an acre. And it took a long time before that tree grew to the next one. And then inside that tree, there was this whole area where there were very few leaves and nothing grew. It was all shaded by the upper part. And when I was a kid, we had ladders that were up to 26 feet long. And there were stories about 28 and 30 foot ladders before I was old enough to help with that. And at one time we did rent some trees from the Harrison farm that were lady apples. Who knows what, anybody familiar with lady apples? Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're about that size and little red cheek, and they were used for Christmas decorations. And we still grow some. But we have them on dwarf trees now. But anyway, these ones we used to rent, to reach the bottom limbs, the lower limbs of these trees, you needed a 24-foot ladder.
Cool.
And so there was a lot of space with just air. And I remember going up that ladder, and it just wasn't a good feeling, because I liked the tree where you had some branches down close to the ground to catch that ladder, you know, and it just was never a good feeling, you know. Things gradually changed, and I remember in the 1960s, my dad planted his first mutsu trees, and I think it was some sort of experiment with somebody. They were on three different roots, one which was a full dwarf, and the other was an interstem, and then one a little bit bigger than that. So they were different sized trees, and it was a double row, which is things that, you know, people kept trying that to increase the density, put two rows together, but the weed control was always the big issue with double rows. And in Europe, they were doing triple rows for a while, but they had trouble with the weeds too. So today we're planting trees about 3 feet apart, and I have some that are on 10-foot aisles, but I've kind of backed off from that a little bit because I have a lot of slopes. So most of them are 11 or 12 feet now. And that's about, well, if it's 3 by 12, that's 1,200 trees per acre. And we, for a number of years, we planted at 3 or 3.5 by 14, and that was just under 1,000 trees per acre. And they're dwarf rootstocks. The trees are all grafted. And the rootstocks that we're planting, many of them came from trials, or not necessarily trials, but they collected rootstocks from all over the world in England in the early part of the 20th century. And we're still using a lot of those rootstocks, although there's newer ones. Some are from Russia and Poland, and some are from Geneva, right in New York. So these trees, these dwarf roots that are somewhat much weaker than the seedling roots that they used to plant the trees on, the benefits are that the tree is very precocious. Most of them, we have to go out and pluck flowers off the trees the year we plant them. Mm-hmm. And then the second year too, depending on how the tree was structured when we got it and how well it grew in the first year after we planted it. And so they need to be supported. So we build trellises now with 12-foot poles and 5 wires. And that's what my mom wanted me to mention. Mm. I guess she's still impressed that we do that, but it kind of seems mundane to us because we do it, you know, all the time. For a number of years, we just used 1 wire overhead, and we were using 10-foot poles, and then we had a metal conduit by each tree. But the conduit got expensive, so we quit doing that. And then we went to three wires, and we put a piece of bamboo for each tree. And the bamboo got expensive, so we went to five wires. Some people are still using the conduit. Kent, you're still using the conduit, right? Oh, no, that's right. You're using a wire.
Yeah, right.
Wires. Ken's got two wires overhead, and then a wire that comes down and gets wrapped around, and the tree grows into it. Mm-hmm. So it's a little bit different. So we because of that, we have to harvest in every row instead of every other row. But the advantages are if we get a tree with branches on it from the nursery, which we don't always get. It depends on the variety and how the growing seasons were and different factors like that. But if we get the branches we want, 8 or 10 small diameter branches that are fairly flat angled, we can hang some apples on that tree the second year. Mm-hmm. And if we could have 10 apples on those trees with 1,000 trees of the acre, that's 100 bushels. Mm-hmm. You know, in the old days, they'd wait 5-6 years under the best of conditions. If it was northern spy, it'd be 10-12 years before they saw any apples. Wow. His spy is not precocious. It was very desirable variety, but it's not precocious. I planted some in 99 on dwarf root stock, and they were much better, but they're still kind of an odd tree. So
so what was a good harvest in the 1950s for acre?
I don't know exactly, but I would guess that probably somewhere is around 300 or 400 bushels in the 1950s would have been exceptional. Whereas today, depending on the variety and other factors, we're looking at 1,000 to 1,200 bushels per acre minimum. Yeah, it should be 1,500, but that doesn't always happen. I've talked with colleagues in Western New York that have had certain blocks with certain years that have approached 3,000 bushels per acre. Yeah, which is really exceptional. Well, I understand in New Zealand that's not uncommon, but their climate is more perfect than ours, and their soils, I guess, are very good. Yes.
So if you look at the map in 1936, there's more farmland, but less production?
Oh, I'm sure there was less, yes. Yeah, so I haven't studied this, but I would guess that in 1936 there was 3 or 4 times the acreage of apples that there is in the town today. But I would guess that we harvest more apples
now today
than then. Sure. Now maybe in the late 60s or 1970s, there may have been more apples harvested in the town than there are now, but I kind of doubt it. I kind of doubt it, because the orchards today are so much more productive. Yes, sir?
Has it changed the population of Red Oak? Who's working on these farms when your grandfather was there versus your dad versus your
father? Oh, yeah. My grandfather had mostly local help. Like I mentioned, Lou Sism, who lived right next door to us, he worked for us year-round, pretty much full-time.
He was like a foreman or something?
More like hired man than foreman, yeah. The crew was small enough that they didn't really have a foreman. And that's another big change. When I remember when I was a kid, my dad was always with the help. And everybody was doing pretty much one thing. Of course, they only grew apples, so there was usually only one task going on at a time. Occasionally, he might be with a few men doing something, and then Lou was mowing or something like that. But today, partly because we grow so many different crops, we have lots of different things going on at once. And then in my dad's day, they had most of the seasonal help was from Florida, African-American, some Jamaican that would come seasonally. Usually midsummer and then leave around the end of October. And we had that same help until in the late 80s. But in 1987, I first got Jamaican help under a program called H2A, which is through the federal government, and we can bring in seasonal workers. And now I normally get some as early as the end of March for pruning and planting, and they're here until mid-November, and then I get more usually around 1st of June. And it's the government seems to make it a little more complicated every year. Delays, yeah, she does that too. Dave used to, and how would I say, the guys are, even though there's a little bit of a, there's definitely cultural differences between, us and the Jamaicans, but, and they're different than the cultural differences between us and my Guatemalan family, who are with me year round. And, but there are ties there that are familial. And also there's the familiarity that they have with my farm and that I have with them, because they've been with me, some of them, since 1987. Mm-hmm. And that has a value that's hard to quantify. But yet the federal government sees them as unskilled workers that can be replaced by almost anyone who's breathing. And, we don't see it that way. Part of the deal with the HUA workers is that we have to advertise in various other states, and once in a while we get workers who will come and we'll put them to work, and usually they find out that this is not really what they want to do, physically, or well, part of it's desire too, it's not just, but a lot of it's physical, they're just not used to that sort of work. Whereas, unfortunately for the most part in Jamaica, that's how the guys farm. I mean, they use their hands, they have very few power tools, and they're very good with their hands, and they're very good with hand tools. Although many of them are good machinery operators as well. And so that's another thing that's changed a lot in my lifetime.
So there are no kids jamming in the bed for the working papers the way we were. When we were kids, and the first thing we did was to go throw hay for Irving, older than that is,
yeah,
for 25 cents an hour.
Yeah.
When Joni and Mary Kay drove the H&EM, and Irving ran the baler.
Yeah.
And that was it. Those days are gone. Are there any high school kids here whom you employ?
Yes.
Wow.
Yes, we do. Very few of them have ever worked in the field. They help at pick your own at the farm stand and also at farmers markets. In fact, we do four or five, once the season gets going, four or five markets a week in Westchester County. And we hire high school and college kids there. And we've given a lot of kids their first job, and at the farm as well. And for about 4 years now, we've had a training session where we try and get all the kids from Westchester to the farm and talk to them about various things, and I give them a tour. And it's good. Even the local kids learn a lot on the tour too, because even though they live here, they just don't know a lot of what goes on the farm. And I haven't given up on the present generation. There's a lot of kids that...
Lloyd Kellerhouse has kids still.
Okay.
Pay with him.
Talia's saying that Lloyd Kellerhouse has kids that help him with hay. I know I did straw when I was a kid. That was my first job off the farm for Gerald Boyce, who was my dad's friend. And I remember getting paid $2 an hour. I thought that was... Whoa. It was quite a bit more than my dad was paying me. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Mr. Mead, we've never met, but I'm one of those students that got its very first job being hired by your father.
Okay.
Now I'm going to be 80 years old in a couple of days, and this is in the late 40s.
Okay.
I was a student at Red Hook High School. I used to jump the bus, drop me off there in the afternoons.
Mm-hmm.
If it was nice, trim the trees, or if it was nasty, we'd repair boxes in the upper floor of your big red barn.
Yeah.
Nailing them, fixing them, so that, and it comes picking season, we'd be picking them, and those 24-foot ladders were not a pleasant thing to
hide. No, I know, they work, yeah.
Those days are gone, but
yeah.
I grew up and I learned a lot, and it and made a better person out of me for praying under the tutelage of your father.
And your name?
Henry Wilbur.
Henry? Oh, yeah, I know the name. Yes, yes.
Mm. So that was an experience. Oh, and by the way, one other thing, a little bit of history. On a weekend sometime, my father would come up with a wiggly old truck we had, we'd get some apples,
yep,
and we'd go peddling them. Mm-hmm. We used to go to what is now called Tivoli, but was then called Madeline.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
We'd go to Red Hook.
Yeah.
Got way out in the bushes and Pine Plains even once in a while. And wherever we could peddle two apples out of the back of the truck, that's what we did on some of the days later after the season was coming down.
Yeah. Yeah, it was before
a lot of it was recreated by your talk here.
Right. It was before the organized farmers markets. Yeah. Trucks, I remember one time my younger brother Nelson and I, we were riding with Lou Sism, and at that time we had two or three Model A, 10.5 trucks. I think they had a 12-foot...
Double A's.
Yeah, 12-foot flatbed, I think, with wooden racks.
They were double A's? Double A.
Okay.
It was a 10.5, yeah.
Yeah, my grandfather loved Model A's. He had various ones around the farm. He had one that was shortened with dual wheels with two transmissions, a doodle bug, that he would use as a tractor. But these were the regular trucks. Mm-hmm. There were two that ran that I recall, and one that was, I guess, for parts. Many years later, it had a tree like this growing between the bumper. It didn't move for a few years, you know, in the fender. But we were riding, we were going to the cold storage that was in Rock City, which now has a sign out front called Leo's Apples, which most recently Ken rented. And we kept some squash there last winter. We were going up the hill, just before Hateman Hill Road, where the airport used to be. Mm-hmm. And the truck got a little warm, and the radiator cap flew off. I guess that would happen sometimes. And so Lou pulled off the side of the road, and we were scratching around the weeds trying to find a radiator cap. And I guess we found it. I don't remember the rest of the story, but I was pretty young. But at that time, most of our apples went to the Red Hook Cold Storage, which was right behind the Rhinebeck Bank. And I believe that was built in the 1920s. And at that time, the technology in apple storage was double concrete walls. I don't know if they were poured or blocked. I think they were poured, but I don't know. And then the space in between, they filled with ground cork. And when it burned in 1973, that's what burned. Yeah, and it's very hard to put it out because it's inside this concrete on both sides. And it wasn't 73, it must have been later than that. Dave doesn't remember that. It must have been later than that because we had apples there in 73.
Yeah, yeah. It was more like...
Maybe it was late
70s. Yeah, 79 or 80.
Yeah, yeah. But I can remember, we had a 1954 Ford at that time with a flatbed that held 14, by this time we had moved from bushel and an eighth field crates to 18 bushel wooden bins, and this truck held 14 of them. And after I graduated high school in 1973 and traveled most of that summer, came back about the 20th of September, a good friend of mine from high school and I went to Alaska that summer, and I think to this day still the longest time of me being away. came home and I was part of the apple picking crew for about 10 days until our truck driver got another job, and then I got promoted to truck driver. And right near what used to be the phone company building over here, the brick building, there was a maple tree in front of that building. And it had a low limb. And from a car, you didn't notice that limb. From a truck, you could not see the stoplight until you were almost there. And back then, the brakes were not as good as the trucks we have now. So you kind of had to decide if you were going to stop or not before you could see the light.
Chuck, do you have some pictures? Do you have some images? I thought I saw some.
Yeah, we do. Sorry, I get talking.
I mean,
yeah,
it might illustrate some of the things.
I have
one question about your map.
Sure.
What was the logic behind the rerouting of Curly Corner?
You know, I don't exactly know.
They made it straighter.
Yeah. Well, they made it straighter, yeah. Maybe it was because there was more traffic.
The two ends of the county corner.
Yeah. Well, it's definitely straighter.
Absolutely.
And it made us have a lot less traffic. But I don't know exactly what the logic was. Because they went through some pretty wet...
You don't think it has something to do with your dad?
No, I don't.
I don't know anything about it.
Because he would have only been 24 years old when that happened. Yes. Yeah.
On the old road, there's a culvert. The cement embankment side was narrow. Mm-hmm. That's probably the reason why, because cars coming to...
Yeah. You mean the bridge. Yeah, the curly bridge. Yeah, yeah, it's got stone. That could have been the reason, yeah.
It was very narrow, and if two cars coming out of that direction, you're going to have problems.
Yeah, that could have been the reason.
That's why they changed it, I think.
Yeah. And the bridge on our end of Sism Road was a little bit wider, and it had pipe railings, which I remember spending a lot of hours sitting on those railings, watching the water go underneath.
Peter Bridge on the Valley Road, 1924.
Yeah.
Somebody stole the marble plaque when the bridge was redone, but fortunately Woody was still alive because they wanted to straighten the bridge. Straighten the road. So it's the only thing that slows traffic on our road anymore.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
That's this winter.
Yeah. So these pictures here, if you can see, this is my grandfather, Gordon, and his I think his friend's name is on the back. But this building is still on our farm, although it got raised in the 1930s, and it has two garage doors where the stone is now, and the cattle. And this is my grandparents, Gordon and Faye. And probably that was taken at their place over in New Preston, Connecticut, that my great-grandfather built near Lake Warmock, that for many years was operated, run as an inn. My dad's cousin ran it. It was called the Boulders. But now it's no longer owned in our family. It's a private residence now. And this is my mom's house. And we think that's probably in the early 1950s, judging by the cars. And it still looks very much like that. You could advance it, Bonnie, if there isn't a question. And this is my parents. I don't know if that was before you were married, probably.
Oh, yeah.
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 His pants rolled up. We don't know.
We don't know. You got any ideas about that? Mom, my dad rolled his pants up?
Just trying to show his good.
Yeah, I don't know. We don't know. So.
He just grew in a hurry.
Yeah. And then this is my parents in 1987. The picture set, and then this is about 10 or 11 years ago. Myself and Linda and Dad and Mom in front of our farm stand by our barn.
So what's the stuff in the front there?
Looks like just some wood of some sort. So, yeah.
Raw materials to use later.
Yeah, right. Or you might need that.
Look at that.
Yeah.
Now you can see the
This one up here, this old photo, you can see the Catskills, and you can also see that there are some woods to the west there, but not as much as today. And then you can see the woods down. This is a current day photo from the hill at the top of our farm.
And yellow.
Yeah, and then these two on the bottom, Julie took on Friday.
Okay.
The other ones are before 1920. And I don't know, but I'm guessing they were very soon after my grandfather bought the place in 1916. And you can see the house pretty much looks the same. Back here, this was the summer kitchen because they cooked with wood. And so it got hot in the summer, so they cooked outside in the summer. And you can see the barn. It's kind of hidden here by the white cedar trees, which are about 6-inch diameter there. And today they're about like this. And you can see the windmill. And you can see the garage behind the windmill. Now the windmill pumped water from a hand dug well that was over here somewhere. And it went from, there was a kind of a stone lined pit under the windmill. The windmill was before my time, but the pit was still there. And just up on the slope, up here towards the upper floor of the barn, there was a cistern built into the slope. And that collected water from the roof of the barn. And that water all flowed together, and some went to the barn for the cattle to drink, and some went to the house for drinking. And just behind where the photographer was standing is the stream. It's sometimes called the Stony Kill, in some time called White Clay Hill. In fact, my grandfather first named the farm White Clay Creek Orchards, and I changed that name about 30 years ago because it seemed kind of awkward, but it was historical. And the washing water was pumped from the creek with a one-cylinder that my dad always loved to call a one-lunger, gasoline engine that was in the basement, presumably the exhaust was piped outside, into a 800 or 1,000-gallon iron tank that was in the basement. And so they had two water systems, basically, one for washing and one for drinking. And my dad always told me that the electricity came in 1929. And up until that time, my grandfather and my dad was too young. He was born in 1924, but they did cut ice. There was a small pond that's just the other side of the present day Curly Corners Road. In fact, Curly Corners Road took part of that pond. It really looks small today. And I can't imagine how they would ever fill the ice house with it. But maybe they didn't fill it, but they worked at it. And I couldn't remember the ice house when I was a little guy. But they stopped using it in 1929 when they got electricity. And they stopped maintaining it. And so it was in disrepair when I was a kid, and so my dad pulled it down. But the stone foundation and part of it was concrete. My grandfather did do some work on that. And it had three doors. The east-facing door was at the ground level, and then there was another door that faced north that was about probably 6 feet above the other one, and then the last door was on the west side, and that was probably 12 feet above the floor. So as you filled it, you went in a different door. Mm-hmm. And they packed the ice and sawdust. Actually, upstairs there's a wonderful display, display of ice dioramas of ice making on the Hudson River.
Yeah, so afterwards, please feel free to go upstairs.
It's very interesting. What's there, that was a huge industry before modern refrigeration. So so this on the right is standing just near the front porch of my mom's house and looking east. And it appears, it's hard to say, it appears as if Sism Road was dirt at that time, gravel. And you can see over here, there are some apple trees here. And these are the white cedar trees. And this is an elm tree, American elm, that succumbed to the Dutch elm disease and I think was cut down in about 67. We have some photos of the day it was cut down, but I was very upset with my father that they actually hit the ground before I got off the school bus. I wanted to see it. I was upset. I came home and it was laying there. But anyway, the big part of the trunk, right at the ground, it was about 6 feet in diameter. And that part got hauled away into a, put with a stone pile. But the rest of the tree, for several years, we cut and split for firewood. And has anybody ever tried to split elm?
Terrible.
it's nasty stuff.
Impossible.
Yeah, we were using hammers and wedges. No log splitter on the tractor back then. And you sometimes a wedge would be there for a year. And then it would start to rot, and then you could drive it through and get your wedge back. But and I don't know exactly, but this looks like maybe a maple here. That tree's gone. And right about, pretty close to where that one is, there's a huge white birch now. At the center, you can see it in the neck. Yeah, there it is. Sorry. The center broke out in a thunderstorm about 30 years ago, but it's still going strong. And then this is a black walnut that my dad planted. And you can't see it here, but there's a chestnut out there too that he planted. Mm-hmm. And you can see how big the white cedars have gotten. And you can see a few newer buildings that we've added. So things change, but they stay the same. So
is there more? Oh, there's more.
Yeah, there's a few more. Yeah. Yeah, in 2003 we began to plant some blueberries. And they were on property that we bought in 2001. Back a little bit from that, in 1998, we were approached by Scenic Hudson to if we wanted to sell our development rights. And we decided that what they were offering was not enough, so we kind of held out for a little while. But then in 99 or 2000, we applied for purchase development rights through New York State and also Dutchess County at that time had funding. And our application was accepted And it took until very early in 2001, we were able to buy 82 acres of the what was then the Joyce Farm, which had been the Klum Farm for many years. I don't know the whole history of the Klum Farm, but it was a long time. It was a dairy and fruit farm, which was very common around here, dairy and fruit, that combination. And where these blueberries are was a Concord vineyard that my dad said he could never remember the grapes not being there. It had been abandoned about 20 years when we bought it. And there were cherry and ash trees in there around 6-inch diameter. There were poison ivy vines about 2 to 3 inch in diameter.
I have an interesting story.
Yes, yeah. Some of the grapes were still alive. And the wire was rotten enough that it didn't cause us any trouble. And the pH was almost low enough to grow blueberries. Because for all those years, they sprayed the grapes with sulfur. The main malady on grapes is powdery mildew, and sulfur was the control, and it lowers the pH. And over the years, so we only had to put on a little bit more sulfur to make the blueberries grow. And we cleared it in 02, planted blueberries in 03, and very soon after they started to bear, we discovered that we grew tired quickly of sharing them with the birds. So we netted them.
Yeah, and, is it definitively better to net them? Some of your brother growers don't net them at all. And
just... Yes. Well, yeah. Our neighbor who has probably 3.5 to 4 times as many acres of blueberries readily admits that he loses at least 20%.
Yeah.
So, but he has more acreage and he lives with it, you know. It's quite an investment.
Sure.
It's quite a lot of labor to put it out. Now, the ones that you can see from Route 9 that kind of had the bluish colored netting, that's a different system that was more of an investment, but it takes a lot less labor to put it out each year. It also has more poles and more wire. Yeah. You know, so it was a significant investment. But they both work well. And
these you can actually walk under.
So. Yeah, the newer one that's near Route 9, the poles are 2 feet taller, so it's easier to drive machinery underneath. And, and these are a couple pictures of blueberries that Julie took. And here's some apples.
Well, that was it.
Yep, that's it. These are just a few more.
That's my collaging.
Yeah.
That's the collaging, okay.
A few more on the bottom of the current day, and then the sometime... I think between 1916 and 1920 at the top. So,
great. Thank you.
Thank you, John.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So, Julie, you have to come up here. I have to thank you and Chuck.
Thank you.
Now you can show your support for Distorting Red, for the history of Red Hook. So, this is for you, and this is for you. You have a new hat to wear when you're outside. Yeah, thank you. So, please.
I just want to invite everybody to the farm. We have pick your own on weekends, starting in June with strawberries, and then we go right through to the end of October through pumpkins and apples.
Cherries, meantime, blueberries, peaches.
We have cherries, blueberries, peaches. Pick your own.
Yeah.
Pick your own. But I also want to say that I'm very proud of all my children, but I'm especially proud of Chuck and Linda because they got an award for the greatest tonnage of food that was contributed to the food grant.
And Beth, it was interesting to find out that you were one of the very first from Brooklyn, this migration from Brooklyn. Because certainly it's a very active route now. It seems like all the young farmers are coming from Brooklyn.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. Please join us in the tap room. Great to have you here, and then we can continue the conversation. Thank you, Julie and Chuck. Let me turn this off.
I guess I'm old enough to be the star.
Yeah,
well, that's a story.
Say,
I'm sure, right next to the